Speak to me, I'm listening. Well, good evening and welcome to our final session this evening. As you're coming in and finding a seat, shall we stand together? We'll begin by praising God together.
The mission of the European Leadership Forum is to unite, equip, and resource evangelical leaders to renew the biblical church and evangelize Europe. All of Jesus' disciples are called to love God with all of who they are and to love their neighbor as themselves. James depicts this as being mature and complete, not lacking anything. The author of Hebrews challenges the readers, by this time you should be teachers, and exhorts them to go on to maturity, explaining that the natural result of growing to maturity is the ability to love and teach others. In essence, biblical maturity is biblical leadership, loving God and loving people. The Bible often depicts this in an organic way, like a tree growing and bearing fruit. The following leader impacts are an attempt to describe this biblical model of leadership, of growing to maturity in Christ. In response to God's incredible love for us in the gospel, leaders respond with joyful love for God. Paul describes believers as trees, rooted and grounded in love. Leaders are disciples and disciple makers. Discipleship is only effective once we recognize that we are blessed with every spiritual blessing. Jesus uses the image of a seed that bears fruit a hundredfold as a picture of a disciple who clings to the word and is teachable, honest, faithful, and persevering. Biblical leaders disciple others to spiritual maturity. Leaders think and teach with a robust biblical worldview about all of life, leadership, and ministry. The Bible's qualifications for a leader are spiritual, moral, and relational, with one exception. A biblical leader must be able to teach the truth while refuting false teaching. Leaders love others the way Jesus did. This love is lived out through acts of service, kindness, encouragement, honesty, and forgiveness. Loving others is the motivation for how we use our gifts, live out our calling, and communicate the gospel. Leaders use their spiritual gifts to love and serve others. Leaders submit their gifts to God in order to glorify Him and help His people. They have a godly ambition to build up the body of Christ. Leaders live out their calling. Paul had a calling to be a spokesperson of the gospel before kings and rulers. In Romans 15, he expresses his desire to preach the gospel where it had never been preached before. A leader's calling provides direction for what to do and how to do it. Leaders seek to persuasively communicate the gospel and train others to do the same. Every Christian should be eager to share the gospel. In fact, a desire to share the gospel is a sign of our love for others. Leaders guide churches and organizations to be healthy and fruitful. Peter explains that God has given us everything we need to live a godly life, a mature life. If we possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will help us to be effective and productive in ministry. Leaders develop fruitful ministry partnerships. Biblical leaders give their time, talent, and treasure to others in order to extend the growth of the gospel. The Forum works intentionally towards these leader impacts in order to see evangelical leaders grow to maturity in Christ. But it doesn't stop there. When leaders are growing in these qualities and living them out, the results go beyond the leaders themselves. They impact their churches, organizations,
a warm welcome to you all to this final evening of ELF. We have had some wonderful days together, and we still have this final evening together, and we have great expectations for this night. I'm Stefan Gustafsson from Stockholm, Sweden. I'm not sure I should tell you this, but since we are family, and I will tell my family this, yesterday night, I had no idea I would be called up on the stage. So I was just sitting, very relaxed, and I looked down, and my fly was open. But no worries. So I just thought, whoops, and I zipped up my pants. 30 seconds after that, someone called me to the stage. So, I know that there are mercy for sinners, but obviously there's also mercy for idiots. I hope you've noticed that here at ELF, we want really to be cutting edge. And, you know, all over the world now, people are talking about artificial intelligence, AI, and chat GPT. And I thought we should test it. This could be something for ELF. And, you know, you don't have just to write into it. You can just talk to it. Let's try it. Okay. So here's a random question. What is the most important competition in Europe? And which two countries 2023 are the most outstanding in that competition? Oh, Eurovision. And you have to say that those two countries really stand out. Sorry, Alex. The Brits paid me to do this. Okay, next question. I have to say I'm really impressed by artificial intelligence so far. So, next question. Show us another country where Sweden is number one. Whoops, that must be a mistake. My confidence in AI just dropped. Okay, final test, the decisive test. Which country in Europe has the most sophisticated way to celebrate Midsummer? Oh, Sweden again! That is called small frogs. So, I hope you look at this as an invitation to come to Sweden. If you survive the shooting, you can join us in dancing small frogs. Okay. Well, I have some other announcement too, besides inviting you to Sweden. So, about our departure and the airport shuttles. You can find your departure time outside of the plenary hall. You need to arrive in really good time, 30 minutes before your shuttle is leaving tomorrow. It's very important that we respect each other in this area. So check out your return shuttle. We all need to check out from the hotel before noon tomorrow. And if you have a pre-forum, you need to check out before the pre-forum. Otherwise, you will be charged for yet another day. You can put your luggage in room three, on level three, and it will be secure there. And if you have have had any a room service, you should pay for them yourself. There are so many people an evening like this that we would like to thank, people that have served us so well. And there are three groups that I specifically want to mention. The first is the amazing worship team under the leadership of Chris. Thank you so much. You have led us so well in worship, and we have been able to enjoy so much good music. So thank you. There is another group, and that is the amazing tech guys back there. Thank you so much for the hard work you put into this to make this such an excellent experience here. And then there's a third group. And now I would like you to wait with the applause a little bit until I tell you. So I would like to ask all our volunteers to stand up so we can see you in the room. Please stand up. No, wait. I hope you felt the warmth of that. People couldn't stop themselves from clapping. We are so thankful for what you have done for us, coming here on your own cost, serving us 24 hours a day, and you have done it with so much joy and kindness and servant heart. You have not only made the whole conference so smooth in terms of organization, you have been a very important part of the whole atmosphere, and we couldn't have the European Leadership Forum without you. So we are so thankful for what you have done for us here. As you heard before, tonight we are going to do the very comprehensive evaluation. So I hope you have your smartphone with you. Later in the evening, you will be able to do that. There will be a QR code. There is a link in the app. So I'm just preparing you for what's happening later in our time together. Now, the most important announcement by far. And that is from 2 Timothy, chapter 1. There the apostle says, "For the Spirit God gave us does not make us timid, but give us power, love, and self-discipline. So do not be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord. He has saved us and called us to a holy life, not because of what we have done, but because of Jesus Christ, who has destroyed death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel." This is the night where we are sent out from ELF. The preceding days that they have been for us, I hope you have been richly blessed personally and that you are uplifted and encouraged. But what has happened here is not only for us. It is for others. And we are sent out all over Europe and in some places all over the world to share the most amazing news. Death is defeated. There's an offer of life for everyone. And we are called to participate. We, in our weakness, we idiots, are called to participate in God's rescue plan. And that is what we are sent out to do, in His power and with His presence. We are going to continue to worship, and after the worship, Jelena Sivulka will come up and introduce our prayer time.
Should we stand together? In our own languages at the same time. Let's celebrate our diversity here. Let's celebrate Europe. Let's sing together.
How great.
Well, let me just note that we are late, and it has nothing to do with anybody from the Balkans. A few years ago, my husband and I went for a dinner, and we asked a babysitter to watch our severely autistic daughter. We came home a few hours later, and our daughter was asleep. She was fine, but the babysitter was completely in tears. And we asked her what happened. This young girl has watched Hannah a few times. She's really sweet. She came from an atheist family, never heard the gospel. And she was watching Hannah, and this happened only then and never before. She said, "Hannah asked me to pray." Hannah can barely speak. She could, but she never asked anybody to pray for her. We pray for her. She never asked. So this young girl said, "How about you pray?" And Hannah prayed for mom and dad, spaghetti and laptop. She knows her priorities. And then this girl said, "That happened more than 2 hours ago. I never stopped crying. What is this?" And I told her, "I think my daughter brought you in the presence of God." When Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, disciples were praising and rejoicing, and the Pharisees asked Jesus to rebuke them. And then Jesus said in Luke 19, he answered, "If these were silent, the very stones would cry out." God is going to speak. He's going to use children with autism. The stones will cry out. But let us pray that we are not going to be silenced. Let us pray for the renewal of biblical church across Europe and spread of the gospel and the boldness that we joy that, that we join the renewal. Let us pray that in the face of challenges and pressures that awaits us, we're going to completely depend on Him. And let's give God praise for these days that we had together. So let's get in groups of three or four and pray. close our prayers. And let me pray. God, thank you for this amazing time. Thank you for again pouring yourself and your presence on us. Thank you for this great time we had here. Thank you, Lord, for the possibility and opportunity to go and to serve. Help us not be silenced. Let us be part of the renewal in our countries. Let us not be silenced. Let us be bold. Let us go home in the power of your Spirit. Let us go and speak. Use us. Let us not tremble. Let us not be weak. Use us for your power and your glory. I pray in your beautiful name. Amen. 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 I forgot to tell you that actually the girl became a believer and it's part of Hannah's hope. She asked.
Thank you. Great. It's my pleasure to introduce tonight's speaker, who almost needs no introduction. It's such a joy for us to have Lindsay Brown here. Lindsay has been the General Secretary for IFES, the International Director for Lausanne. He's launched FOIR, the Network for Student Evangelists. And you have been a close friend of ALF for many years, and you are such an example and model for many of us here. You are known also as a mentor and a great encourager, and you have had that role of encouraging a number of times in my life. We are grateful that you are here, and you will speak about standing on shoulders of giants, lessons from the early church. Let me pray. Lord, we thank you for Lindsay, and we now pray that you, through him, will speak powerfully into our lives. Amen.
Thank you, Stefan. Just a few years, the last 15 or 16 years, I've been involved in a developing network of university evangelists all across Europe, and we gather together once a year in late October. The grandfather of this movement was the giant, although he was short of stature, evangelist Michael Green. And he came to speak to us for the last time before he was taken to heaven just a few years ago. And I remember his last speech to all the evangelists, in which he said, we were meeting in northern Greece near Thessaloniki. As I flew into Thessaloniki late in the day last night, he said, I looked down below me and I could see these lights flickering all across northern Greece. And it reminded me, he said, of how I see the situation in Europe today. There are many lights flickering across the continent. And he said, what we need to pray for is that it becomes a flame enveloping the whole continent. Now, many people.
Your microphone going to the backwards.
This is because in Wales we're not used to microphones. We just shout at everybody. And hope for the best. And. You know, we have a saying in Wales. We have a saying in Wales that if you're communicating the gospel in public and your arguments are thin, just shout louder and hope for the best. So that's what I'm going to do. Michael said he saw these flickering lights down below him in northern Greece, and that he was praying that the flame, a flame would envelop the whole of Europe. The situation in Europe is not actually as bad as many people in other parts of the world think it is. There are many flickering lights, some beginning to flame. In the last 20, 30 years, the church has grown enormously, for example, in France, which is a big surprise to non-Europeans. Maybe now more than 500,000 evangelicals, when there were just not much more than 200,000 when I lived there in the 1980s. The growth of the church in Albania from 3 or 4 believers in 1990 to maybe 20,000 believers these days. The growth of a church planting movement across Europe, which is evidenced in countries like Germany, Norway, France, and several other countries. A strong student ministry, and many other encouragements all across the continent. But perhaps they are small flickering lights, and they need to come together as a flame. On the other hand, the situation is bad because we face the three-headed monster of pluralism, materialism, and secularism. And it's a challenge to work in the midst of these hostile enemies. Just over 100 years ago, the famous Russian speaker, writer Tolstoy said, "He who wants an easy life has been born in the wrong generation." And that certainly applies to the context in Europe today. So the question we have to ask ourselves is, where can we look for help? And I've been asked this evening to give you a historical perspective of what we can learn from the early church as part of the help we seek. I think there are three sources for help and encouragement. There's obviously the scriptures, which is foundational for us. There are messages from other parts of the world, and we've heard some of them here. We've had speakers from other parts of the world. Many of you didn't hear the presentation by Bishop Hua Yong, which was a brilliant analysis of some of the challenges facing us and the lessons we could learn and should learn in the West from the rest, as it were. We've had contributors from other parts of the world in the Congress or the conference also. And we certainly need to be humble enough to listen to the voices from the growing church in Africa, Latin America, and Asia. But thirdly, we can learn from history. There are no easy answers. Every generation is different, but there are pointers and even principles we can learn from other generations. I'm not a prophet, but it's my perspective that we've lived through a golden era in terms of evangelical giants in the Western world. An Asian friend told me last year, so much power is in the hands of Western Christians and money. When are they going to hand over to us? And I said, well, it will come soon enough. Because the first 500 years, people were asking that question about the church in Southern Europe and North Africa, where many of the great leaders come from. In the last 40 years or so, the giants in the Western world have included some who have just gone on to heaven in recent days: Tim Keller, George Verwer, Michael Green, Billy Graham, Eric Alexander, all Western names, J.I. Packer, the author of Knowing God. But if you asked who were the giants in the first 500 years of the church after the New Testament, there wouldn't have been a single North American or a single British person or a single person from Scandinavia. So give us a chance, because for the first 500 years, the great leaders were named Polycarp, Tertullian, Athanasius, Justin Martyr, Origen, Irenaeus. And I want to introduce you briefly to some of those folks this evening. Now then, before I give a kind of historical presentation, I have to convince some people of the vital importance of studying church history. On the first evening, Emmanuel just said that it's important that we remember God's acts. Peter, tripping over himself in one of his letters in the New Testament, actually said, "Remember not to forget what God has done in the past." Martin Luther in the 16th century said, "There's nothing so short as a Christian's memory. We forget so easily." Once I was in Israel visiting a museum with a student. I always try to visit museums when I go to a new country. this student was showing me around, and he knew that I was by training a historian. He said, "I'm not really interested in history at all." And I said, "Well, that's a shame, because we were in the Museum of the Holocaust. You can't understand your culture unless you have a historical perspective." So three or four benefits of history for those who remain unconvinced. It demonstrates how believers have dealt with similar problems in the past. So as we look back, we see trends in history. It can help us avoid mistakes that were made in the past. As one person said, history repeats itself, has to, because no one listens. Thirdly, it encourages us as we see how God worked through fragile believers in the past, and as we see him using them with all their flaws, we are moved to think, well, perhaps he can use us too. But fourthly, looking back at God's acts in history and in our lives is key to discerning our own identity, who we are and where we come from. As John Lennox, who's often spoken here, said, if you don't know where you've come from, you won't know who you are, and you certainly won't know where you are going. So for all these reasons, and I could give many more, the study of church history is important. As I look back on the history of the church, however, there are two great periods in European church history from which we can learn. Before I comment on them, I want to introduce you to a great historian in the last 50 years, the American Kenneth Scott Latourette. You may wish to look this up in due course. He was professor of divinity in Yale School the States, and he wrote 7 volumes on the history of the expansion of Christianity. As he looked back over 2,000 years of history, he argued that you can discern what he called 6 weapons in the Christian's armory. Watch out for them as you look at periods of history. And he said they were prayer, evangelism, example, both personal lifestyle and community, argument, which includes apologetics, action against injustices and so on, and action in society, and surprisingly, suffering, both the way that we respond to it in the world and also our preparedness to perhaps die for the gospel. We'll come back to most of those as we look at lessons from the early church post-New Testament. Now, 6 years ago, I was asked to give a different presentation on lessons from the Reformation. It's impossible to understand Europe today without understanding something of the Reformation. And the presentation I gave has been put into a book called Into All the World, The Missionary Vision of Luther and Calvin. And in summary, I think there are 3 great lessons from that period of the Reformation in the 16th century. The Reformers recovered the essence of the gospel, which had been clouded in traditional Catholicism over Roman Catholicism over the centuries, particularly the great and cardinal doctrines of justification by grace through faith, which Luther said was a mark or a standing or a falling church. If you're not clear on that, he said, you'd be wrong on everything else: the nature of man, the nature of God, the nature of Christ, the nature of salvation. Now, most historians are aware of that. What many have not picked up, but historians are picking up in the last 20 years, is that they went beyond clarifying the essence of the gospel and great doctrinal truth to applying the whole of scriptures to the whole of life, what some people called the Christian mind, applying biblical truth to every sphere of life, not just a few carefully chosen ones like abortion or capital punishment, but every area of life, including the visual arts, as well as the sciences and education, and so on. That reshaped the European continent. And it's had its impact for 500 years, supplemented by periodic revivals. Now, things are dying out because we haven't really had a revival in Europe, except in some places like Romania, over the last 100 years. But we see the impact in the legal system, in education, the formation of universities, so much else, as the Reformers applied biblical truth to every sphere of society. The third dimension was that they renewed their missionary and evangelistic vision. Many historians say that Calvin in particular, but also Luther, didn't have any missionary vision. That is highly disputable, because by the time that Calvin died in the 1560s, There were 2 million Huguenot Protestant Christians in France out of a population of 20 million. Missionaries had gone out from Geneva, as one great historian in Oxford, Geoffrey Elton, said, refreshed by springs from the fountainhead, taking the gospel to the ends of Europe, which is basically the world as they knew it. Well, you'll have to read up on those lessons from the Reformation. But I suggest that we could learn from those three things held together. Sometimes people argue that we need another Reformation. Sometimes people argue we need a revival. Actually, the church grows best when you have both. We are to be involved in the Reformation, or the calling back of the church to the great truths and the application of Scripture to the whole of life. But only the Holy Spirit can sovereignly ignite all of that into a flame across the continent. And if you have a revival without church leaders engaging in the reforming process, which is what happened in Wales in the early 1900s, the revival impact dies out. You have to have the two things at the same time. That is a cardinal lesson from the Reformation. But having said that, let's move on then to the first few hundred years of the church after the New Testament, until the time when Constantine decided to bring into being the Roman Catholic Church at the beginning of the 300s. I'd like to suggest four lessons we can learn from that 300-year period. There was a great German historian called Adolf Harnack in the early 1900s when he was asked, how did the early church grow? And he argued they did two things. They outlived and they out-argued the pagans. And I want to highlight that in terms of the four lessons that we can learn from the early church post-New Testament. First of all, their lifestyle was attractive before the watching world in at least three ways. On the slide, you should be able to see a seminal book produced over 20 years ago by an American sociology professor called Rodney Stark. And he was trying to investigate the causes of the rise of Christianity. The subtitle of his book was, How Did an Obscure Marginal Group Become a Worldwide Religion? And he argued several things. First of all, the existence of koinonia, the creation of a new community, which led to a gathering of people who were trans-ethnic, Jew and Gentile, slave and free, male and female, trans-cultural. One of the revolutionary repercussions of the gospel in the New Testament was the creation of a new community which went beyond one ethnic community. It wasn't just made up of Jews. This was a powerful testimony before the watching world. And in fact, if you read some of the early documents in the first century, they talk about, for example, sharing the Lord's Supper and sharing meals beforehand. The Lord's Supper often followed on from the sharing of a meal, which was to symbolize the gathering of a new community together. This is a major lesson of the New Testament. And I look in vain for evidence of churches in the early centuries that were mono-ethnic. It's very hard to discern and to find arguments for a church which is uniquely made up of British or Americans or German or French or any other ethnic group. Sometimes these churches existed, of course, because of language specifically, but often from the very beginning, they cut across the ethnic divide. That has mega implications for the future church in Europe as we have the world coming into our European situation. And it has implications for reaching the diaspora, people coming here because of warfare or other circumstances, and also for reaching international students. Actually, as you look at the New Testament, the Acts of the Apostles, try to reflect on how many people you can think of in Acts who were converted at home. I can think of Timothy, not many others. Many of the new believers from Acts onwards were converted when they were away from home. This has huge implications, both for our engagement with other ethnic groups within Europe, grafting them into the life of the church, even though it's difficult, and for our testimony before the watching world. If I think of it globally, some years ago I was visiting Burundi in Central Africa. There had been a civil war there, about 200,000 people killed. The fighting wasn't between white and black. It was between Hutus and Tutsis. The Hutus were short, Tutsis were tall. While I was there, fighting broke out in the university. Quite a number of people were killed. But then the principal of the university came out to speak, and he said, "Our culture is in danger of disintegrating. But there are three types of people on the campus: the Hutus, the Tutsis, and the Christians," who were singing in the open air, "We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord," and shouting out, "In Christ there's neither Hutu nor Tutsi, we are one." He said, "If we want to survive as a culture, we'd better listen to the Christians." And he wasn't even a believer at that point. That's been repeated in other places. Some of you here are from Albania or Serbia, and you will know that in these cultures there were tensions between the nations, and yet we see certainly in the student world partnerships in terms of Christian witness in the universities in those countries. The second dimension to lifestyle was diakonia, or self-giving service. The church has always struggled with its attitude to the world through history and come up with three options: separation, cut yourself off from them, or assimilation, what Andrew Fellows in his book calls enculturation, taking the world into the church, or thirdly, engagement with the world. And the theological basis for engagement with the world is the incarnation of Jesus, who, when his Father sent him in the world, didn't say, "I don't mind going into the world to save them and maybe even to live with them, but could I please wear a spacesuit so I won't be contaminated by them because they're so fallen?" Jesus came and dwelt among us, and the New Testament said he was the friend of sinners. Question for many of us is, do we have any sinners for friends at all? Anyway, the dimension here is of diakonia, self-giving service. And in his book, Rodney Stark points this out when he particularly refers to the arrival of two pandemics in Europe in around 150 AD, and another one which lasted for about 15 years between 251 and 265 AD. In that time, the second pandemic, as much as a third to a quarter of the people living in most of the major Roman cities, dominated cities in the south of Europe, died because of the pandemic. It frightened the authorities. There was no antibiotic or treatment for it. Some people were so frightened of their family members dying, they just put them out in the streets before they died. And contemporary testimonies indicate that believers, including elders of churches, went out into the street to care for the dying. Many elders and leaders died. And there was one letter written by and spoken in churches across North Africa and Southern Europe from a bishop in those days, in which he spoke of the sacrifice of leaders in the churches as they sought to care for the dying. The emperor, pagan emperor Julian, as a consequence, said, "These Christians are outdoing us in good works. If we don't equal them, they'll take over the empire," which is what happened in the next 75 years. I think the best summary of this kind of behavior comes from John Stott in this brilliant quotation where he says, "The calling of the church is to be morally distinct without being socially segregated." And we've often confused the two. And the challenge facing us, therefore, is how we can engage in our culture today. The Ukrainians are doing it by reaching out to people with blankets and food and so on, and we see the response all across the country. It's difficult when there's a welfare state to do that in a country. But we must be looking at ways in which we can engage with people in our culture, those who are poor, those who are struggling to make ends meet, who don't have enough food to live, those who are struggling to adjust to a new culture and learn a language. I was just in a week of mission in one town with 20,000 people in Wales, 5,000 of whom were from other cultures, 140 cultures, countries living there. And they had a day where they provided food for some of these people and language classes twice a week. And huge numbers turned up because the church had found a way of engaging with people in the community. The third dimension to lifestyle was the new ethics. One professor of history, Keith Thomas, who taught me in university and was not a Christian, says that this was the defining feature of the new Christian church, their new ethics, their treatment of the unborn. They were opposed to abortion. The treatment of the newborn, it was not uncommon. Early documents demonstrate for Roman males especially to say, kill the child off if it's a girl. I'm only interested in having a son. Their treatment of women, because the early church leaders stood against abortion, they stood against infanticide, they stood against child brides, and they defended widows when their husbands died and their brothers came in to take over the property and put the widow and the children on the street. That's why James wrote those words in James chapter 1, true religion is to care for the orphans and the widows. That was the context. When I read this chapter in this book by Rodney Stark, I don't particularly get very emotional, but I have to confess the hairs on the back of my head stood up. I was so proud at the treatment of women and children in the early church in those few hundred years. And Stark says that the church didn't grow like that very fast, as some people tend to think, between the end of the New Testament and the time of Constantine. There were two spikes, and they correspond with the time of the two pandemics in 150 and 250 AD, as the church was engaged in that context. Early documents like the Didache also, a kind of early church discipleship manual, have statements to say, we do not corrupt children, and also sanctifying marriage. It says, we share our food, but not our wives. A very high view of marriage. It was not unusual for Roman men to have sexual relations with minors and with prostitutes. Hear then these remarkable words from John Chrysostom, the golden-tongued preacher, who became the archbishop of the Bishop of Constantinople, in his commentary on Ephesians chapter 5, in one of his homilies. Many people loved him because he was a practical preacher, whereas many preachers just spoke in terms of allegories. This is what he's recorded as writing on the passage in Ephesians 5 about husbands caring for your wives. Take then yourself the same provident care for her as Christ takes for the church. Yes, even if it shall be needful for you to give your life for her. Yes, and to be cut into pieces 10,000 times. Yes, and to endure and undergo any suffering whatever. Refuse it not. What an astonishing statement and a standard which he's bringing to bear for men in terms of caring for their wives in those early centuries. No wonder lots of people were attracted to his preaching. Let's move on to the second lesson we can learn. Lifestyle was the first thing. Remember, La Tourette's emphasis on lifestyle and engagement in the community? There it is in the early church. The second is they sought to persuasively communicate gospel truth. They both defended orthodox Christian teaching against heresy, and they articulated Christian truth and belief before unbelievers. I don't have time to spend a lot of time speaking about some of these great apologists. Irenaeus, who was born in Izmir or Smyrna in present-day Turkey and moved to France, where he became Bishop of Lyon and was executed there. Tertullian, born in Carthage in North Africa in 160 AD. Justin Martyr was born in Rome. But then you have Athanasius, who defended the deity of Jesus, who lived in Alexandria. Origen was another great leader at the time who was born in Alexandria. Four of those five were North Africans, born incidentally, as was Augustine later on. So you can see how the strength of the church was mainly in the south of Europe and in the north of Africa at that time. Brief comments on some of these folks. Just before he died over 10 years ago, I went to see John Stott, the great Anglican leader, for the last time, and I asked him, John, what do you think are the biggest challenges facing the church today? Number one, he said, pluralism. The notion that there are plurality of sources of truth, and Jesus is not unique. Some things never changed, because that was the challenge in these first few centuries too. Irenaeus, for example, in his writings, he wrote 5 books against heresies, and he attacked the Gnostics. Gnosticism comes from knowledge. People spoke of a secret knowledge to find spiritual fulfillment in life. And without getting technical in his books, some people were arguing that the God of the Old Testament was not the same as the God of the New Testament. What he defended was the unity of scriptures and the goodness of God. He argued that both the New Testament and the Old Testament were inspired by God. The heretics at the time argued that Luke's gospel was, but he argued that all 4 gospels must be read together to get a full picture. He also argued for the humanity and the 100% humanity and divinity of Jesus. The kind of challenges we faced with liberal theology in the 20th and 21st century. Let's go on to Tertullian, whose apologetic book effectively was what one person called the capstone of the age of apologetics. His father was the leader, the captain of a Roman legion, so he was quite wealthy, and he paid for Tertullian to be well-educated. Subsequently, he trained as a lawyer, and he was converted at 40. And his writings are really an attempt both to deal with heretics and to defend the gospel before the watching world. He was the father of Western theology, if you like. He coined the word the Trinity. He attacked the heretic Marcion, who denied the deity of Jesus. And he mounts a brilliant defense of religious liberty. Now, this is important, because last year I was talking to Stefan, and he said to me, when it comes to the law, we've lost the case of on issues of sexuality all across Western Europe. He said, let me tell you what the next challenge is, religious liberty and restrictions on religious liberty. And if we lose that, we're in deep in trouble, because the next step is persecution. Well, if you want an example of how to defend religious liberty in the 21st century, go back and read the writings of Tertullian, because he was doing it in the second century. And his defense included the statement to the that the church was self-supporting. It provided a peaceful anchor to the state. It was a blessing to the country. And that believers who were attached to the church were amongst the most diligent people in the culture. So he mounted a defense of believers and a defense of religious liberty, freedom of worship in that context. He also wrote on the theme of persecution, and that we should not go looking for it, he argued, but if it comes our way, we must be prepared to endure it because of the truth of the gospel. So famously he said, the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church. The third person mentioned there is Justin Martyr, and he may have been the most significant. What is interesting about him is it's a little bit like the Apostle Paul in Acts 17, because he takes quotations by great philosophers like Socrates, who challenged the existence of a multiplicity of gods. And he says, I'm building on the arguments that Socrates, your great philosopher, argued of the nonsense of many gods, and that there is only one, and then he presented the one in the person of Jesus Christ. And so, like Paul, who quoted Aretas and Epimenides in Acts 17, Justin Martyr quotes non-Christian thinkers who have some insights, not the full truth, and builds on it. So in some ways, he's one of the fathers of apologetics, because he provided an intellectual defense of the truth. The other interesting dimension to his arguments is that he argues that one of the reasons for the truth claims of the gospel is the fulfillment of Old Testament prophecies in the New Testament. When was the last time you heard a sermon looking at Old Testament prophecies fulfilled in the New Testament? I remember Josh McDowell of Campus Crusade writing a book on this called Evidence That Demands a Verdict. We don't write or speak about it much these days. Yet the early church argued that you can see the fulfillments of Old Testament prophecies in the New. This vindicated the deity of Jesus, and it also vindicated the connectedness of the Old and the New Testament as both being from God. So let me summarize in terms of the challenges they faced: pluralism, the unity of scriptures, the usefulness of the Old Testament, the deity of Christ, the Trinity, persecution and religious liberty. Ever come across those recently? Well, look at the early church fathers and see their defense of these things, because they're a great example of how to do it. Thirdly, they engaged in teaching and discipling of new converts, as well as defending gospel truth against heresy. I wonder if I should stop referring to myself as a church member and just say, when people ask me, I'm a disciple and a follower of Jesus Christ. The word disciple and discipleship is much stronger than the overemphasis in some churches on church membership. And there are three ways in which they demonstrated this. First, there was the Didache, which I referred to, probably published between 50 and 75 AD, an early discipleship handbook divided into two sections, defining the way of life and the way of death, answering the question, what is Christianity? The first section was a summary of the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 5 to 7, and emphasizes loving God and our neighbor. The second section speaks about instructions for baptism, the Lord's Prayer, fasting, the Eucharist, preceded by meals together to reinforce the sense of the new community in the first century. Wesley picked up that again in the 18th century. We've lost it. When you eat together, then it's much easier. You have a deeper sense of unity as a community when you take the Eucharist afterwards. I think it could be reinstored in many churches. And there was teaching on Sunday worship and church leadership. He has some interesting comments in the Didache. For example, he says he refers to itinerant preachers as apostles. I wonder what would happen if we followed this instruction today. He said, if you have an apostle coming to your home, let him stay one night or maybe two nights. If he asks to stay for a third night, he's a false prophet, and send him away. And he said they should accept no money, just provision for the night. I wonder what he would have done with all our multiple fundraising letters which flood out from the church. I'm not speaking against it. I'm just asking the question about focus in terms of our expression of discipleship. And he says, don't give harsh advice to slaves who hope, if they are believers, in the same God as you, because it may make them fear you rather than God. Origen was an early church father. He was a prolific writer. Rowan Williams, the former Archbishop of Canterbury, says of him and some of the early church fathers that they had an obsessive concern to communicate. No doubt influenced by the Apostle Paul, who, of course, wrote many of the New Testament letters. Origen, for example, is probably the third most prolific writer in the history of the church, I think behind Augustine and probably Luther. Luther, who wrote on average a 200-page book every 2 weeks at the height of the Reformation. Absolutely phenomenal. Nobody's done that since. Origen, at 18 years of age, succeeded Clement of Alexandria in Egypt. He wrote 13 commentaries on Genesis, 36 on Isaiah, 29 on Ezekiel, 25 on Matthew, 32 on John, and thousands of sermons, which were noted down in shorthand and then transcribed. And so there was this commitment to write the Word of God and teaching and training for the benefit of the church. Secondly, early councils occurred frequently in those early centuries, because the church leaders saw the acute responsibility of clarifying core Christian doctrine and truth. As far as I can see, there seems to be evidence that the word evangelical was first used not in the Reformation, but in about 180 AD in the debates with Marcionism, which argued that the God of the Old Testament was capricious and different from the Christ of the Gospels. And some of the early church fathers defended the deity of Jesus and the God of the whole of the Scriptures. And one of the writers in the debates at the time talked about those who are evangelicals are those who are trying to hold on to authentic New Testament Christianity. So we should not despise the term, but the key lesson from that is the term evangelical should not be given up. It's in the statements by ELF, because it's an early word describing authentic biblical Christianity. It predates the birth of Roman Catholicism and Eastern Orthodoxy. And therefore, when sometimes folks from that background say you are, in English, Johnny-come-latelys, you just came into existence in the 16th century, the answer is, historically, no. The early believers were called evangelicals before the state churches came into being, because of their aspiration to sit under the authority of Scripture. And so they were involved in defending biblical truth in the face of Marcion and Arius. Again, he was challenged by Athanasius in Egypt when he asked questions of the deity of Christ. Two implications, because we need to move on. Firstly, the importance of doctrine. When I was a teenager growing up in South Wales, I always remember one church leader saying to me, doctrine just divides. Biblical doctrine is given to strengthen us. And one of the best statements about the importance of doctrine is in the Song of Moses in Deuteronomy. It's either chapter 28 or 32. I can't remember off the top of my head. Where Moses is quoting the words of God, who says, "My doctrine will come to you like the dew in the morning." In other words, the purpose of doctrine, which is God's teaching, is not to bore us. It's to refresh us and bring us to life. You can't grow deep without understanding the great doctrines or truths of Scripture. And key involvement in discipleship is equipping even the humblest and the simplest of believers to understand the great monumental truths that gird us and strengthen us and root us in Christ. And that's why in the New Testament, so often Paul spends half of his letters, the first half, outlining a particular doctrine. So we should give attention to doctrine as well as praxis. Secondly, the role of theologians. Many theologians are just laughed at. They're viewed as peripheral. If you're a theologian and you tell somebody that's what you do, usually they go on and ask a question about something else in your life, because they can't see the relevance of it. Theology is the queen of the sciences, however. We need to have theologians in Europe today who stand for truth and will not take a backward step. And we need some of you who are professional theologians to take a lead in the life of the church and help to clearly articulate and outline and clarify the great truths in Scripture in such a way that your readers and your hearers are filled with a conviction the gospel is true, powerful, and wonderful. The role of the professional theologian is not to bore people, it's to captivate them with the greatness and the wonder of the gospel. And sometimes theologians have lost their way because of the debates with liberal theologians, but we should pray that God will raise up such people to give direction to the life of the church. So we need theologians who will lead us to the great truths of Scripture, and we need to understand the great doctrines of the Scripture, doctrines of God, which ground us and give us depth. I'm very much involved with a ministry to Iranian people. The Iranian church is the fastest growing in the world. At the moment, there were 20 Iranian churches in 1980. There are over 1 million Iranian evangelicals now, spread across Europe and in Iran itself. They have 170 missionaries in Turkey. They're reaching many Afghans with the gospel. But what strikes me about this ministry called Elam is that as soon as someone makes a profession of faith, they have prepared something like the Didache, a discipleship manual, which is called Safar. Everybody goes through it. And it involves being baptized, and it involves teaching people to be prepared to be persecuted and lose their lives. Maybe we are offering a soft discipleship, sometimes making a distinction between profession and becoming disciples, profession of faith and becoming disciples, and we need to learn from the early church fathers. Well, we're coming to the end. I know you must be weary. The fourth lesson that we learn from the early church fathers is the importance of persevering and being prepared to die for truth. I don't have time left, so just you should know that many of these leaders were executed. Irenaeus died in Lyon, Justin Martyr, as goes with his name. Polycarp was one of the greatest who lived in the first century. He was a disciple of John. And you will know that the word martirio in the New Testament is often translated in our Bibles as bearing witness to Christ. The two went together. That's how they understood it. One pagan wrote to the Christians who faced death at the time, "They are immortal for all time. We live forever," which explains why they despise death and voluntarily give themselves up. Polycarp, who lived from 69 to 155 AD, was burned at the stake, and actually they stuck a sword in his body too, because he took a long time to die. They gave him a chance to deny his Lord before his execution, and he famously said these amazing words, "86 years have I served him. He's done me no wrong. How can I then blaspheme my King and Savior? You threaten me with a fire that burns for a season, but you are ignorant of the fire of everlasting punishment prepared for the wicked." And then he looked up to heaven and said, "I bless you, Father, for judging me worthy of this honor, so that I may share in this honor in the company of Christ and the martyrs of the church." I need to conclude with one brief story and a personal reflection. Some years ago, I was talking with Ajit Fernando, who came to speak at this conference, and he told me this story of a missionary who went to the South Pacific to work with headhunters. He worked there for 30 years. No one was converted in that time. So in the modern era, some people would probably give up on supporting him because he couldn't speak of any professions of faith or even much growth that was occurring or openness. They were opposed to him. Anyway, he died, and the missionary agency sent a young missionary to take his place. And within 2 years, revival broke out on the island, and thousands were converted. So the young man went to see the chief of the tribe, and he said, "Sir, you had this wonderful godly missionary here for 30 years, and no one came to follow Jesus Christ. I've only been here 2 years, and revival has broken out. It's obviously got nothing to do with me." And the chief looked at him and said, "You're right, young man, it's got nothing to do with you. That missionary was here for 30 years. He was a godly Christian, a follower of Christ. And over all those years, he told us, you should not fear death. For when Christians face death, it's like going from one room into the next, and Christ is there waiting for them. You should know that we worshipped, we were involved with the demons, and we were fearful of death and the dark arts, and we were petrified when death approached. He was not, he said. So we watched him until he died. And then he died. We saw he was not afraid. That's when we believed." And I want to tell some of you who have been working in cross-cultural work or even in some tough countries in Europe for decades without seeing much fruit, you are being watched. And our role is to serve Christ faithfully and trust the Holy Spirit to do his work. We would love to see him bring about revival, but in the meantime, we've got to get on with the ongoing work of bearing witness to Christ every day and trust that he will bring the fruit. And so I want to close with one final brief comment and two Bible verses. The comment comes from a missionary I knew who served overseas for decades, returned back to the UK as an older man, and he was struggling to walk at the end of his life. He lived in a two-story house, and he had to walk up the one story to the bedroom. And he was finding it difficult. So he created a little plaque, which he put on the wall, which he saw every time he went upstairs to the bathroom or the toilet or the bedroom. Every time he walked up the stairs, he saw the plaque, which had two words on it: die climbing. That's what these early believers did. They died climbing. And that, brothers and sisters, is the lesson for us in the 21st century and for us in terms of our Christian ministry. We should all aim to die climbing. And in that context, here are the two verses for you. As we had a quotation from 2 Timothy 4. They will turn away from the truth and turn their eyes and their ears to myths. But you keep your head, brothers and sisters, in all situations. Endure hardship. That's what some of us will have to do in Europe. Do the work of an evangelist. Discharge all the duties of your ministry. And then he goes on to say, I have finished the race. I've kept the faith. When Michael Green phoned me up the day before he died, he said, I know the text I want you to speak at my funeral next week. He said, I think I'm going to heaven tomorrow. He did. He said, I want you to speak on that text. I've finished the race. I've kept the faith. That's our calling. In a few weeks' time, I'll speak at the funeral of George Verwer, probably, in my view, the greatest American missionary mobilizer of the last 60 years. Maybe the most influential missionary leader in the world over the last 60 years. Just before he died, he released a final word with a quotation from one Bible verse, and it's one of my favorites. I think it would be great for all of us to memorize it. It's 1 Corinthians 15:58. After the long explanation of the resurrection, Paul says, therefore, my dear brothers, this is a word for Europe today, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is never in vain. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the myriad saints all across the generation, the cloud of witnesses that the book of Hebrews refers to. We thank you for the many in Scripture, but we thank you also for those in the early church and the early centuries who took these truths to heart and stood for Christ. O living God of heaven, please fill our minds and our senses afresh with love for Christ and with a sense of the wonder of the gospel. Then help us to stand and stand again, to go forth into the world, discharging the work of the gospel and the ministry of evangelism. Help us to persevere joyfully to the end. Help us not to give up. Help us to encourage one another. And, O God of heaven, please grant us breakthroughs across our continent as we humble ourselves before you, knowing that we deserve judgment because of what we've done in this continent, but crying out to you for mercy, for fresh blessing, advance and growth. Do it, Lord, for the glory of Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Shall we stand together?
To me, save them.
Please be seated. In a few minutes' time, when you leave this room, please turn in your name tag to the volunteers who are standing there. There will also be prayer volunteers who can pray together with you, pray for you or with you. So if you want someone to connect with in prayer, make use of that opportunity. Now we have two things left, and the first thing is the evaluation. And that is really crucial for us, that you all help us with that. You cannot leave the room until you have finished that. And we ask you to be honest and be affirmative, but also let us know critically and give us input. We read every word and we try to shape the forum along the information we get from the evaluation. So there is a QR code. You can open the app and there is a link. And we will take 5 minutes now where you can work with the evaluation. If you finish it before 5 minutes, just take some time and thank God in your heart. If you not manage to finish it during those 5 minutes, no worries. You can continue after. And then we will finish the whole forum with an amazing song together. So, take out your phone, start the evaluation. Let us know what you think. Thank you.
can't tell if people have finished. No, they haven't finished. You're just on Google, aren't you, or you? If you haven't yet finished, please do finish in a bit. But we're going to stand and sing and celebrate our Lord and Savior and the grace that he's shown for us. Shall we stand together and we'll celebrate?
The past.